you.
It's Monday Music Day, and here once again singing their smash hit, The Same Love, we have the Jets.
We'll be showing you the next episode of our club movie, The Secret of Lost Creek, and we'll be answering some more of your mouse mail.
That's right, but first, it's time to be serenaded by the soothing sounds of the super sensational Mickey Mouse Club Choir.
Jenny, don't pick that quarter up off the street.
Why not, Mom?
You don't know where it's been.
And now it's time for another episode of Where It's Been. Today, the quarter in the street. Our quarter started its journey in humble fashion as copper ore extracted from a New Mexico quarry. After the copper was purified and sent to Philadelphia, skilled hands at the United States Mint combined it with nickel alloy and fed it into a coining press. Soon our quarter emerged, all shiny and new and ready for adventure. It was then sent to the First National Bank of Midvale, Ohio. There it was given to Frank Brimley, local mailman, who was cashing his paycheck. 2 weeks later, he gave it to his nephew, Luis Alvarez, as a bribe to stop practicing his accordion. On the advice of his mother, Lewis deposited the quarter in his piggy bank. There it remained for 2 months until an unforeseen accident put it back into circulation. Lewis then used the quarter to purchase a comic book, issue number one of SpongeHead and Mop Girl. This comic would have eventually been worth hundreds of dollars to Lewis if his mother hadn't thrown it out. The new vendor took the quarter and placed it in his pocket, which, unbeknownst to him, had a hole in it. The quarter tumbled out into the street, and rolled 7 blocks away, where it was just found by a lucky Jenny Huckabee.
Gee, Mom, I never realized what a strange and varied life the average quarter leads. Can I pick it up now?
Why, of course you can. Now that you know where it's been.
Join us again next time as Where It's Been takes a look at the chewing gum under your desk.
Where It's Been is partially funded by the National Foundation to cram kids' heads full of useless information.
See, do you know what all these letters are? They're some of the 10,000 entries for our Mouseketeer for a Day contest. We want to thank everyone who took the time to write to us. And if you haven't already sent in an entry, sorry, the deadline is passed. Well, this Friday we're going to announce the winner, and next week that lucky person will get to spend a whole day with us right here at the Mickey Mouse Club. So check us out on Friday, because you might be our Mouseketeer for a Day.
And now it's time once again for Mouse Mail, that part of the show where we answer mail from you, our club members at home.
Right now, our first letter comes from Judy Cothran of Gadsden, Alabama. Now, Judy writes, "Dear Rocky, I would like to know who your biggest influences are and how did you feel when you were picked to be on the Mickey Mouse Club?"
All right, well, there's only one person who can answer that one, right?
That's right.
Rocky.
Let's get her out of
here. Rocky.
Come on out here, Rocky.
Come on, Rocky. Hey. Come on,
Kenny. Well, you heard that. What do you think?
It was great. Of course, well, I want to thank you for writing. My biggest influence overall is my mother. Performance and singing-wise, it's Patti LaBelle, Anita Baker, Barbara Streisand, Oprah Winfrey, Felicia Rashad, and Michael Jackson. And I was really excited when I was accepted for the Mickey Mouse Club.
Did you jump up and down and go crazy?
Oh, yes, I did. I did.
I couldn't have put it better myself. Thank you, Rock.
Thank you.
Boy, I'm glad you two announced it. Well, we have another letter, and this one's for you. This is from Susan McCaffin from McAllen, Texas. She writes, "Dear Damon, where did you live before you became a Mouseketeer?"
Well, Susan, thank you for writing. You know, before I came to Orlando, I used to live in a small, out-of-the-way place. Take a look. Oh, I'm so bored. Can't stand this place. There's nothing to do, and I am sick and tired of eating coconut cream pie.
Well, take it easy, Damon. Believe me, you'll get used to living here. The first 15 years is the hardest.
15 years?
Yeah.
With nobody here but you and Skipper, that millionaire?
And his wife.
Oh, no way. I am getting out of here, even if I have to swim to the mainland.
Don't do it, Damon. You'll never make it. Come on back. Things will get better. Listen, we're getting table next week. Skipper! Yeah, you know, you learn the darndest things on these mouse mail segments.
Boy, I tell you, you wouldn't believe it, would you?
No, no. But, you know, we love hearing from you. So if you have a question or a comment for us, send it to Mouse Mail, Mickey Mouse Club, Disney MGM Studios, P.O. Box 10200, Lake Buena Vista, Florida, 32830. And if we use your letter on the air, we'll send you a gift certificate for dinner for two at Uncle Willie's Corn Dog Hut.
All right.
No, actually, I was kidding. Actually, you get something much better than that. You'll get a Mickey Mouse Club t-shirt, and I hope you enjoy it.
Oh, yes. Now, here's Ginger and Maueva and Lindsay with another episode of the Mickey Mouse Club movie, The Secret of the Lost.
You know, working at the newspaper is turning out to be a lot more interesting than Jimmy thought it would.
I know. First, there was the buried treasure. And now there's the mystery surrounding Robert's picture of Bigfoot from the camping trip.
But remember, nobody's certain that it is a picture of Bigfoot.
That's right. But why does someone want to steal it?
Let's see.
Whoever it was got into the Bigfoot file. Your picture and negative are gone, Robert.
Oh, man, I was going to be famous.
This is weird, Grandpa. If the picture isn't that important, then why would someone steal it?
And who would steal it?
It's good questions, both of them. Just wish I knew the answer.
I think we should start by making a list of all the people that knew Robert took the picture. Rossi knew.
And Cammy. But neither have any reasons for wanting to steal it.
And that only leaves Bigfoot.
There you are. That was old Bigfoot. He came in here and stole that picture to give to his girlfriend.
Grandpa, this is serious.
Honey, I know it is. Breaking and entering is always serious. But I'm convinced that whoever came in here last night got away with nothing more than a picture of an old bear.
We're leaving someone out. The man that was here yesterday with the black beard.
Jeannie's right, I remember.
He seemed awfully suspicious.
It was just a prospector came to put an ad in the paper.
Well, who was he?
Didn't leave a name. He said he'd check back in a couple of weeks to see if anyone found his burrow.
At least I have a story to write.
Whoa! We're not telling anybody about this. Not even the sheriff.
Grandpa, why?
Honey, don't you realize the ruckus it would cause if we told people Robert got a picture of Bigfoot and then somebody stole it?
Your grandpa's right. People from all over be up here just trying to catch the poor thing.
Remember what happened when we told him about the gold?
I don't believe this. All this exciting stuff is going on. You guys want me to write about stuff that happened 50 years ago. Mr. Gusta, hi.
Oh, Jeannie, how good to see you.
I came to make a deposit for my grandfather.
Well, why don't you go ahead of me? I know you're in a hurry. Do you know that I ran into your grandmother the other day? And she told me you were off on an adventure.
Nothing special, just a camp out.
Oh, I know it's hard to find something special to do here for you young people. It must be frightfully dull for you, especially when you've spent your entire life in Chicago.
Actually, it's not as dull as you might think.
Oh, but the Gold Rush days are coming, and oh, they're a lot of fun.
Gold Rush days?
Oh, yes. Yes, it's sort of a town celebration. We have it every year. Oh, my goodness, excuse me, dear. Cora! Cora, dear, I always come to see you.
Miss Fogle, good morning. And how are you enjoying our clear mountain air?
Fine, thank you, Mr. Butler.
Well, you certainly came at a good time. Forest is spectacular this time of the year.
I'm afraid I'm not much of an outdoors person.
Oh, it's... But let me give you a word of advice anyway. Forest can be very dangerous. Don't get too far off the trail.
I'll remember that.
Have a good day, Jeannie.
You, I need to talk with him.
You like him, don't you?
Robert.
He told Shirley he was gonna, go get an ice cream.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, I know where that is.
Reading.
Nothing that would interest you.
Oxen in the American West. Does this have anything to do with the fifth rhyme, the one about the oxen?
And what if it does?
I thought you told your grandfather you were giving up on all that.
I was going to. But there's nothing else to do in this one-horse town.
Hmm. You're in a bad dream today.
Travis? What does Hardy Sinclair do?
Hardy Sinclair? Not much, except when he's working for P.T. Butler doing errands and odd jobs.
You know, I was in the bank this morning. It was weird. Mr. Butler warned me to stay out of the woods. At least, I think that's what he was telling me.
That is weird.
A lot of weird things have been happening around here. Robert saw Bigfoot, or at least he thinks he did. The picture got stolen out of the photo file, and the only person who could have taken it was the man with the black beard. But the strangest of all is the light that I saw shining in Stoneface's eyes.
Oh, Jeannie.
Look, Travis, everybody tried to make me think I was crazy, but I know I saw it. And I'm going to prove it.
Where are you going?
Back to Stoneface. See what he's got in his eye.
Wait a minute.
Josh, what are you doing?
I'm shaving this balloon.
Why? Is his beard too rough?
Well, actually, we sent a camera into the Disney MGM Studios theme park to see if anybody could do this.
Well, could anyone do it?
Let's watch.
You will like them too. Here they are singing The Same Love. Everyone, please welcome back the Jets.
Yeah.
beautiful song.
And you're Liz, right?
Right.
And introduce the rest of the group.
Okay, from the back is Rudy, Leroy, and Big Ed, Eddie.
Ed back there.
And right next to me is Heine, Moana, and Kathy.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you're great. Great job. Now, I've been dying to ask, when you were here last time, I wanted to ask you this, but you recorded your album, Believe, right, at Prince's studio, Paisley Park in Minneapolis.
Right.
What was it like working there?
Oh, it was exciting and a lot of fun. He came in a few times, said what he thought, and he liked it a lot. And we just had a great time there. They had a basketball hoop and games, and it was a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah? Okay, now, what kind of music do you listen to?
For me, myself, I listen to a lot of old singers, Judy Garland, Patsy Cline, and they all listen to everything else.
Michael Jackson, everything.
Just say all sorts of music? Yeah, you can hear it in your music, too. Sure, yeah.
Okay, and I read, in addition to all the performing and traveling that you do, you all still find time to be spokespeople for Just Say No Foundation.
We like to use our influence on all our fans because a lot of them are pressured in school and stuff. We just like to be a part of the good cause in America.
Yeah, and you work with that, too.
Oh, yeah.
Just Say No, yeah?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
It's fun, too. Yeah.
So
how do your friends react to that call?
Oh, they think it's great. And for us, it's something to really believe in, and to be able to help other kids at it. A lot of pressure out there, so it's good. It's really great.
Right. And we got some questions from the audience, right? Tiffany and Chase over there? Tiffany, over to you.
Thanks, Fred. Hi, what's your name?
Allison, what's your question for the guests?
Do you ever get stage fright when you're performing in front of everybody?
We always get scared. I think that's the biggest thing, is trying to calm each other down and say, hey, don't worry, it'll be all right. Because you hear that crowd out there screaming. They just get all those
shaking
skin and everything.
Hi, what's your name?
Christina. Christina, what's your question for the Jets?
Well, how did you come up with the name The Jets?
Well, we had many names before we became The Jets. We were the Polynesian Pearls, Wolfgang Phenomenon, a Southie Stardust. We had all these sorts of names, and we're looking for a name that people could say and that was very short. And there's a song by Elton John entitled Benny and the Jets, and that's where we got The Jets.
Yeah.
And I think we have a few questions down here. This is Donna, and you wanted to ask The Jets.
How do you choose songs you're going to record?
Well, we just choose songs that sound like us. We're very danceable, that mean stuff that's on our level, like teenage or young adult, and we just go from there.
Okay, and last but not least, we have...
Gary.
Gary, what do you want to ask The Jets?
Since there's 16 kids in your family, how many bathrooms you got?
Not enough. There's still there's a lot of times us girls will be in the bathroom and the boys are knocking. But there's enough. Yeah, yeah. We kind of kick each other in.
Five.
And
You must live in a stadium. It's got to be huge.
It's cool.
Yeah. Well, Tiffany, Chase, thanks for helping us. And Jets, big round of applause. You guys are great.
See you real soon.
Why? Because we like you.
Mickey Mouse Club is videotaped before a live audience at the Disney MGM Studios in Lake Buena Vista, Florida.